Hi everyone, hope everyone's enjoying their IBC experience and thank you very much for Boris and Brian for having me on board today. I'm very excited to talk to you guys. Gonna talk to you a bit about how I got to where I am today, a bit of my background, a few of my favorite effects, some tips and tricks, and you know, some advanced Avid workflows. Let's start with my background. So I was born in Australia. I moved over to New Zealand when I was young. Me and my brother used to skate and BMX in the street a lot. So that quickly sort of progressed to me filming him and, you know, us filming each other. And then I sort of realized that I liked the filming aspect more than the skating and BMX aspect. So then I sort of, the first editing program I worked on was Final Cut. Shout out to all the people that still work on Final Cut. and then from there, my dad sort of saw that, he saw that I took a sort of shine to filming, and he was like, you should check out this film school. It's called South Seas Film and Television School. So I checked it out. And I was like, this is definitely what I want to do. And I'm definitely glad that he sort of pushed me in that direction and, you know, didn't make me become like an accountant or anything like that, because I would not have survived. So from film school, straight out of film school, I was like, oh man, this is hard to get a job. This is like a tough nut to crack. And I had a friend whose dad worked at one of the networks in New Zealand called TV3. Shout out to Mr. McDonald. So Mr. McDonald, John McDonald, gave me my first job, and that was on New Zealand's Next Top Model. So yeah, I was out there. I went out on like the model search and sort of did like a bit of behind the scenes and like a bit of camera work. And that sort of progressed to, being around like a lot of the editors, and I was like, oh man, that's what I want to do. I want to be an editor. So I sort of made that known to everyone at the TV station, and Mr. McDonald then sort of gave me a job as like a, you know, digitizer, intern, kind of just like do whatever, spend a lot of time in the edit suites, and then finally he and then the network decided to give me a job sort of cutting. It was like a music television show. It was broadcast out to about 10,000 people a day, which is like absolutely nothing. And then from there, that's where I really learned my background. Like I learned a lot of filming and directing, and it's where I just sat in a bay for 10 hours a day and just like learned Avid inside and out. And it's funny now because, you know, Avid, I feel like was kind of, I don't know, I never really chose Avid. I kind of just ended up with Avid, but man, I'm so glad I ended up here. And not a lot of people edit with Avid these days, but you know, in my strain of television, you know, it's like the only thing that you can do. Anyway, so and then from there I ended up working on X Factor in New Zealand. And then so I was kind of doing all the, I'll start showing you guys through some of the work that I was doing. So I started doing all the like effects heavy sequences. I was like, effects stuff is like really, really what I like doing. And that's sort of my passion and kind of just like a little niche that I've managed to find myself.
Expector, I was busking, was pretty much like doing little gigs here and there. But now I'm playing to the whole nation.
We all love the stage. Like it just feels like that's where we're born to be.
I can't describe how much winning X Factor would mean to me.
Yeah, so that sort of stuff I really enjoyed doing. And then one day one of the network executives came over from Australia to visit New Zealand and sort of visit the show. And he saw my work and kind of inquired who was doing it. And being an Australian, my goal was to always make it back to Australia and, you know, work in the industry there. At that time, that was my goal. He offered me a job pretty much straight away. So I went over and started working on the Australian X Factor and a lot of those shows with AGT Australia. What else? A lot of the like big competition reality shows is sort of where I've ended up.
James Blunt! Sebastian!
I feel like I'm hitting something I'm going to be talking about for a long time.
Chris Isaac!
That's rock and roll, baby!
Danny Minogue!
That was sensational!
Anyway, so that was about, I think, maybe seven, eight years ago now. So that's where my career sort of started progressing. And then from there, so I should talk about, I guess, sort of where I am now. So from there, I ended up, there was an Australian out in LA, and my end game kind of had always been to end up in LA. So one of my friends at work in Australia sort of saw my work and was like, oh, dude, you got to hit up this guy. Like, you remind me a lot of, like, your work reminds me a lot of his. And it was this place called Burnish Creative. And so Burnish, I hit Ben Delamon up, who was, he's one of the three owners. And we got on the phone, and then we just like, they right at this time was like, they were just starting out their company. So this is kind of the work that like, that Burnish does. It's just like the slickest, you know, shiny floor shows, commercials, you know, like high-end graphics work for like Netflix and online stuff. And I was like, oh my god, this is what I want to do. And then we got on the phone and we, you know, just like immediately got along. And then by the end of the phone call, he'd offered me a job. Took me about a year to get the visa, because it was quite a bit of a slowdown. It was 2016 with the visa department, but I ended up out here about a year later. Had never been to America. It was funny, like getting off the plane and just like seeing, I don't know, just like, it was funny seeing so many movies, and then it's like, oh my god, the cop cars actually look like that. That's not a lie. And then like the Hollywood sign, oh, it actually looks like the Hollywood sign. Anyway, yeah, so ended up out in LA and got a job at Burnish Creative as just like the staff editor. And so I actually still work for Burnish Creative. Just recently made partner there, so that's been awesome. And then the boys kind of saw that I had a bit of an eye, like eye and sort of background in production work. So I head up the production there now. So we do like commercials and music videos, and it's great working at Burnish, because like I get to do like, you know, a little bit of everything, like day to day. Like I love post-production is just like, you know, it's my roots, and that's, I'm sure, something that I'll always do. But it's so good to branch out and, you know, to be able to direct and stuff now as well. Anyway, yeah, so got to LA, and then you know, growing up on YouTube and just being like a sort of a youngster, I was always looking at YouTube videos, and like, I was like, man, this whole like travel thing that's going on, I want to be a part of that. So I started making these like, just like travel videos wherever I would go. I'll kind of jump through these because they're pretty long. Don't want to burn up everyone's time, but. So I sort of really started to develop my style on the side. And, you know, when people ask me when they're getting into the industry, like, what's one bit of advice? I always say to them, like, my first bit of advice is just, like, keep doing your passion projects, because, like, that's where people, you know, even now I still do all these videos on the side. And that's where, like, executive producers of shows and stuff will come up to me and be like, yo, I saw that effect. Like, let's implement that into, like, one of the show openers, or, like, we'd love to have you cut this thing, or, you know. So I always try and push myself on my, passion projects and personal projects, and, like, still to this day shoot them. I just turned 28 last year, so I've been making these for, like, 5 years now. Last week. Turned 28 last week. Anyway, yeah, so I'll start jumping through some of these that I've put together. So yeah, I started doing these sort of travel videos, just like, you know, cool, creative, like very visual looking things. And that has sort of gained me a bit of a following on Instagram, which has been awesome. So yeah, so now I just post all of my work up on Instagram and just, you know, it's like another thing I like to, you know, another piece of advice I like to give everyone is like, I see Instagram these days like as a very, it's almost like your business card. Like when we're, you know, employing new editors and stuff, I always jump on their Instagram, jump on their YouTube, jump on their Vimeo, see what's going on, see if they've got like an eye, you know, see if they, you know, push themselves outside of work. And so, yeah, I always suggest that, for, you know, people that are trying to break into the industry. So yeah, I'll start jumping through some more. So, started making a few more travel videos and stuff. This is another one of my favorites. And, I should say before I keep watching these, I really try to keep everything I can inside. If I jump back to my, Instagram here, I really like to push myself inside Avid. It's kind of one of those things. It's funny. Like when you go into Cinema 4D or you go into After Effects, it's like the possibilities are absolutely endless. So I really just like to sort of see what's possible inside Avid and, push myself and try and keep a whole project inside Avid. So the one we're about to watch now. So we can watch on like the timeline. This is all created inside Avid. So yeah, I really started to push myself with those sort of videos and really gain some traction, you know, on the internet, socially. And then, so that sort of led me to be able to sort of land some bigger clients for Burnish and really push myself in the directing space. A couple of years ago, I directed a music video for Meghan Trainor. Pretty cool, pretty incredible, you know, listening, or you know, hearing these artists' music and then seeing them in the flesh, and you know, they're listening to you and asking what you want them to do, and you know, how they should be like playing themselves and like what the theme is and what the emotion should be. It's pretty surreal feeling. and then yeah, biggest project to date was directed a international commercial for the dating app Tinder. So yeah, that was last year. Yeah, so obviously, you know, from there, that's where I, doing all those like side projects is where I was sort of able to develop my own style and then implement that into, you know, the, like my career and like the things that I was directing or you know, have been editing. So whenever I'm doing that, I'll always try and push my style into it, obviously. And, you know, as a director, that's what they want from you. They want to see your style and, you know, that's why they'll end up going with you. I'm still heavily in the post-production world. So another one of my favorites is I cut this opener for Hyperdrive. It's a Netflix show. Let's see if we can... Yeah, this was... I really liked this one because they said they just wanted something, you know, new and different and like not like anything else they'd seen. So I was like, okay, what can I do? So I took little sounds from throughout the show. Like they delivered me the whole show and then said, cut the opener, like cut like the, you know, the very first thing that comes before the show. So I took little sounds of like engines and like little things like flicking on and switches and burnouts and created my own beat and rhythm, and you can see that on the screen here as we go along.
Here. If you want something bad enough, you do what you need to do and make it happen.
Being a woman in the motorsports industry is a challenge, but I just want to prove everyone wrong.
I don't have a lot of money, but competition, that's all that matters in this life.
Yeah, so that was one of my favorites. It was so much fun to create that. They just basically left me with a whole bunch of footage and then said, you know, make something cool. And I was like, all right, let's do it. Let's skim through a couple more of these and then we'll dive into some Avid stuff and a video that I just released today. What should we do? I'll skim through these real quick. This was pretty cool. This was, they shot this opener for American Idol and they shot it in 8K and they were like, you know, create some, you know, they wanted to basically push in and have these scenes that lived inside this 8K footage. Again, we should probably watch the timeline version. So you can see along the bottom here, me editing along. This is a hybrid of After Effects and Avid.
Time to get all the singers to the wings.
Stage is ready.
Hey Joe, let's make sure we do B flat with this one.
All right, Patrick, call it.
30 seconds to the show.
Riley's parents are here.
Thank you.
Lord, please give me the strength to shine today.
I'm ready to get closer to that American Idol.
Here comes Katy Perry.
I know.
It's one of those days to remember, I'll tell you that much.
Hey Eddie, we gotta get you back.
Yeah, it was cool. So I really, I love to focus on like sound design, as you can probably tell from these crazy timelines. I really like to focus on sound design and like, I really think that's where you'll bring your editing to the next level. You know, like people that come to Burnish, they're like, that's how we really elevate the edits to just something like super crazy. Like you can do all these like cool like effects and like flares and all this cool sort of stuff, but you really need to complement it with some you know, awesome sound design. Just anything else I want to, yeah, some more Idol. Yeah, you get the picture. All right, let's move on to, so this is a video that I actually just put out today. I'm gonna have some offline stuff in here, so we're gonna be looking at the final version and then we'll sort of delve into how I did some of it. All right, here we go.
Nisula.
All right, so that was something that I shot in Italy last year. And like many personal projects these days, that had to take a bit of a backseat, you know, stay super, super busy at Burnish. But, you know, from COVID, having to spend a bit more time at home meant that I got to sort of delve back into some of my personal projects, which has been awesome. All right, here we go. Yep, so here, just doing a very simple, like, sort of wipe transition with the Animat. So this was just like a little piece of this kid running along here. And so, yeah, I saw that when I was like cutting all my footage together. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna bring up Italy Pal Cut. Yeah, I'll kind of go through the process of how I sort of end up with something like that, with a timeline like that. One. Let's see what's good. Yeah, so when I'm going through all my footage, I'm like, okay, I'll see one shot and I'm like, what's that shot gonna link to? All right, the motion in that is going down. I'm gonna find another shot that's going down. And then, so through all my footage, I try and find, like, you know, some sort of dynamic link. So in this first section here, it's obviously my girlfriend, Nicole. Like, she's in the center of frame every time. She's doing the head movement there, head movement there, head movement there, walking. So I always try and find like some cool links like that, whether it be motion, color, literally it can be anything. That's how it sort of makes it feel like it's, you know, one big integrated thing. You can see in my cut one, these are all, I think, things going sideways. Yeah, sideways, all wipes. These are all, I knew I wanted to do like a, just like a thing of all like profile things that lined up. So this is prior to it all lining up properly, but I was like just out there filming doors and cars and bikes, just all super profile. What else we got here? Hyperlapses. So yeah, let's get back to the cut and start creeping along it. So this one here is pretty funny. This is the original shot here. And then, I don't know if you can see Nicole's head there. I popped her head in there. It's from this shot here, from the shot that was, where was that? Oh no, it's coming up. Yeah, so that shot there, I actually plonked her head in there using a, using the mocha. One of my favorite tools from Boris. So you can see her head up there, placed a little thing in there, tracked her head. And then, so that's how she got up there in that little window. A lot of people would never even notice it, but I will. So I, you know, I've got to do it. Another little wipe here. I really wanted to just like do these, like, this is like a four frame wipe. So I just love finding these little wipes in the footage. So this, you know, that person walks past frame there, and I subbed that out and was like, that's gonna make a nice little wipe somewhere. And so you can see this shot here, just like the small little motions I add to everything. So like I'm on my bottom layer here, you can see there's no movement, and then here I add a nice little pan to the right, because the next shot we're going into these doors here that are going sideways. So I always like to, like, you know, lead into a little shot. It's tiny and no one would probably ever notice, but I think those are the kind of things that, you know, really elevates a video and brings it to the next level. So this is where we start to get interesting. So I had this idea. So these here are screenshots from Google. So I went around Italy on Google, and I was like, screenshot, screenshot, screenshot. Where are we here? I'm no pro at After Effects, and generally like to stay out of After Effects for my projects, but this was one effect that I knew had to be done in After Effects. Okay, so I literally, for this effect here, actually I'm gonna come back to that because we do that properly down the end there. Again, just a little nice little wipe there. And so one of my favorite tools, what do we got here? Is this, yeah, warp perspective. Okay, so one of my favorite tools in Avid from the Sapphire plugin is warp perspective. And you would never, ever, ever pick it, because when you drag it on, Brian, if you're listening, don't know why warp perspective when you start out with it. Where is it? Perspective. You drag it on and it looks like this. Looks like this. So a lot of people think that that's, you know, all you can use warp perspective for. Little do people know that I personally think warp perspective is one of the most powerful tools in Sapphire. So I'll come into what I'm replicating here, I should say, is a lot of these little zooms and push-in zooms that are super popular these days. Like, see, that guy's got a big push-in zoom. Let's find a better example of this. Okay, here's one. All right, so this whole thing here was done with warp perspective. Let's just replicate this. So obviously I've just flipped that shot there upside down, and then all this through here is warp perspective. And I could, you know, if I came in and tried to do this same move with 3D tool in Avid, blend 3D, you would rotation. Looks crappy. What this powerful effect has built in is the ability to do motion blur. So in here, why don't we just, so that's my old effect. I'm gonna add a cut here. And then perspective, warp perspective. All right, so always just set this straight to zero. The latitude, set that straight to zero. And then the Z distance, see, I'm seeing three layers of this basically. I just wanna set this to one. And then now I'm back to square one. So, add my keyframe at the top here, keyframe at the end here, where I know I want to go. I want to zoom this right in. It's going to be about, let's say, 0.3, 0.1. So I'm just setting my ending point of where I want this shot to end up. Set my roll. It's going to be 180. Set this a little better. And so what this will do is, when I had my 3D tool, see those edges up here? See how that's actually tiled them? The best thing about this is I can go reflect, and then reflect, and then that's gonna give, it's like I like to imagine it as if you're unfolding a box, and like, rather than just tiling something, or, you know, you see black on the outside when you're doing like a rotation, it's gonna unfold the box of your screen. So now you can barely even notice that that we're going past, that we're, you know, seeing outside of the frame. So that there is just like unfolding the frame. And then, so I'll come in here, and because this looks kind of, see, it's very linear. I'm gonna come in here. I wanna enable my motion blur. But what I wanna do is see how this is very linear, and that's why it's like as soon as it gets to that point there. So what do you want to do here? Ease this bad boy in. So come in here, set that to Bezier, and then see now. So if you can imagine, my scale is at you know, one. It's now going to ease into that. So I need to do it as well with my rotation, which is gonna be roll. See, it's linear. I wanna set this. Use these little bad boys. Set some nice roll. So obviously, basically, it's just gonna get gradually and gradually faster. And boom. Let's render this out. Give this a second to render. And so yeah, this effect can just be implemented in so many different ways. Like I use this effect 30 times a day. At the moment, I'm editing on a show called The Masked Singer. And I will use this effect so many times a day. I'll use it over 3D tool. I'll use it over anything. Boom. So now you can see how that lives in here. Same with that, same with this pan down here. See how I got that nice motion blur, and like how I'm going beyond. My shot actually looks like this, but this enables me to go further with it because it's going to extend past the bottom and look like I'm, you know, doing a full tilt past where my feet would be. And that's able to give me, same thing on the other side of this transition here. That shot actually just looks like that. So this is how that would end up. Yeah. So that's that same zoom, this guy right here. And then with the zoom. So let's keep going along here. Yeah, so a lot of these, when you're seeing this little orange bad boy here, that's me just adding that nice little, it's literally just a tiny little pan to the right, a little fake pan to the right to lead me into the next shot. Tiny, but I think it makes a difference personally. So this section here, obviously, as I was talking about the connection of shots before, this section here is like people just doing like little movements, like head movements. And you know, notice as I'm going along, you'll hear all of these sounds, like, what are we, I'm sure there'll be like a flag, or I love to reuse sounds that, you know, would never necessarily be there, but they sound a lot like it. Like it's almost kind of like from a Foley standpoint, how they'll like say like a bone breaking is actually someone chewing a piece of celery. Like, see if I can find an example of that. Like, I've got some magic chimes in here that I just thought sounded cool with that clock, or, you know, this is an antique clock, and it would never, you know, that's like some big old bell tower clock. What else have I got? Lots of whooshes. Whooshes are very important. I don't care what anyone says. That one's not there. That's, what else we got? Oh, none of those are gonna be there. Anyway, let's keep going. Moving along. Yeah, Yeah, so these are all just hyperlapses that I shot. Oh, no, it's offline. These are all like cool hyperlapses that I shot along the way. Add a bit of a motion blur on the sides there just to really sell them. I don't know if you can see this layer here. Is that gonna give it to me? Yeah, so you can actually see there, I've just got a bit of motion blur, and then I've used a animat to just only have it on the edges. Why don't we go through that? Or is that gonna not let me? Oh yeah, so this is just a radial blur set to 0.9. And then I don't want it to affect everything. I actually just want it to affect the outside, because I feel like that, you know, on an actual frame of a camera, when there is motion blur, it would only really affect the outsides, not as much on the inside. So I'm gonna bring up my key animat, drop that bad boy on there, get a big circle going, and then you can see that it's actually selected the inside, which I don't want. So I'm gonna swap my sources, soften that right off. Boom, there we go. Nice bit of motion blur on the outside to really sell these time lapses. Need that and that. Yeah, so I've had a lot of questions about this. Once again here, so why don't we go through this little stack of effects here. So this is a hyperlapse that I shot going over this bridge. I actually flipped it to go with the previous shots, just to go with the movement. So is that gonna, oh yeah, so originally it was actually on that side of the bridge, and I was like, you know what, that's gonna work better off that shot if I flip it. And then so I knew I wanted to transition into this like match frame sequence thing that I've got here. So I did a little color correction here. So just really sold that sepia tone in there. Let's get out of this. What do we got there? This is a channel blur, is it? Oh, that's a heat wave in there, a little heat wave. What do we got here? Another warp perspective that we went over before. So that's how I achieved that rotation into it. And once again, you can see it doing its thing where it's actually reflecting. You know, if I wasn't using warp perspective and I was just using 3D tool and Avid, all that line along there would all be black, and you know, it wouldn't be reflecting. I wouldn't be able to sell that rotation that I got off of that shot there. And then I believe up here somewhere I've got a channel blur. It's gonna make me re-render it because I did the blur. Let's see if I can control Z all this. Here we go. And then up top here, what do we got? Oh, an S layer, so I've added something on top of there. I've actually put the bird. You can see this bird here on the left. I actually just used an S layer, another Sapphire effect, used the darken mode. So if I went normal above there, you'd see that, but because I used darken, it's gonna blend into that shot and really help sell that transition. And then yeah, so this is where we get into the match cut. Oh yeah, actually, we'll get through this. So another one, so Nicole's hand comes up and grabs the coin. So this, her hand along the bottom there, coming from the next shot. And then what I did was another Mocha Pro. So you can see I've tracked her hand up there. Boom. So she's actually already got a coin in her hand. And I just cut that out. So it looks like she's bringing her hand up. Boom. Coin lands in there. Little shake on top there to sell it. Once again, warp perspective up there. Nice little lens flare here. These online, yep. And nice little lens flare there. And I've changed the color of that. I changed the hue of that lens flare. S layer with an add to drop that on. Ah, yeah, another one here. This is a prime example of a warp perspective. So as you can see, I created this fake pull out of the previous shot. So this is what the shot actually looks like. No pull out there. But I really wanted to like pull out and hit the bell. Bing. So got another warp perspective there. So set all my parameters to 0, latitude to 0, and then Z distance to 1. So that'll, you know, put you at your starting point. And then this I put to 1.3, so that's going to create a nice zoom out. So if I set this to 1, no zoom. Oh, no. What do we got here? Is that why? No. Why is that? Oh, it's because I'm looking at my mix down. Yeah, so no zoom there. So to create this nice pullback, I'm just going to come in here, 1.3. And see, this is a good example of like the unfolding the box. You can see my actual frame is like there. And then so that's just unfold the box and make it look like the, you know, my shot is actually extended out. And that gives me the room to pull back further than, you know, wider than my shot actually exists. Really help to sell it when you add in, when you enable your motion blur here. And so gonna make this nice curve there so that it comes out. Just render this off. Actually, I'll just look at the top layer. Look at that, nice. Pull out. Done the same thing on the other side of this shot. Zoomed right in with my warp perspective. What am I at? Yeah, 0.3. So I've zoomed way past. And I really don't worry about like the footage falling apart too much, because when you have this motion blur on it, you can barely tell the pixelation. And you know, these shots are so quick that you barely notice. Seems like we're running out of time, so I'm gonna skip right to everyone's favorite effect. Another hyperlapse here. Oh yeah, actually, you know what? Why not? Why don't we look at this real quick? Boom. So this one here is another fun one. Actually did film this glass here, shot through the glass. But I was like, oh, why don't I just erase the edges of that glass and make it look like we're going into this next shot here. This other hyperlapse that I did from a boat. With Mocha Pro. So just track the edges of that. So you can see there, that's just gonna cut out the edges of that glass. And then I just moved the glass along to match the movement of this lighthouse hyperlapse. Okay, into the last little section here. So this is a new technique that I've been doing, just like match cutting. It's literally just taking screenshots on Google Earth, dragging them in here. Like, do I have my, oh yeah, here we go. Rectangle, literally just screenshotting, screenshot, 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 screenshot. All these different squares that I could find on Google Earth around Italy. And then brought them into After Effects, and you can see them all stacked up along here. And so what I did was I just started with a red square here. Started right here, just set my guide, and every single thing in here, I've just, you know, I was like, I think I set this opacity a little low here and then just lined everything up. You know, if my, this one started like this, just line him up, perfect. And for any that didn't, see, you can see here, this one, this shape wasn't gonna cover the edges. So I used Sapphire Warp Perspective to extend the edges again to make it look like, you know, that photo was really bigger than it was. So with the red square, you can see that everything lines up perfectly to that red square. And then afterwards in Avid, I added the, like, you know, a zoom in on that so that you can really sort of sell it. Combine that with a bunch of other, you know, match frame technique shots there. Bit more warp perspective with these little transitions. And then, yeah, I always like to try and end my videos right where they start so that if you loop it, whoosh, straight back to the start. So it's cool, you know, on Instagram, it'll just keep playing in a perfect loop. All right, guys, I think that about sums it up. Hope you all learned something today. Follow me over on Instagram. You can get me at Angus Emmerson. Write to me. I respond to like all my messages and DMs and stuff. So if you ever got a question, mainly Avid based, I'll be able to answer it and I'll get to you. If you're ever in LA and there's not a pandemic on, hit me up and come and take a tour through Burnish. It's beautiful offices. We're on the 23rd floor of a building down in mid-city in LA. It's got a beautiful view of the Hollywood sign. We've got about, I think, like 50 bays up there. It's pretty awesome working there because, you know, working in post-production, all of my edit suites have been like dungeons. And so it was super refreshing. Let me see if I can, I don't know. It's a beautiful place. So if you're ever around and there's not a virus around, then come on through. Thank you guys so much for your time. Enjoy the rest of your IBC experience. All right then, thanks a lot.